Now, the first thing to say, don't be fooled by Miltos. He's a smooth talker. And also, he has been talking to you from Greek countrymen, invoking on his country, etc., etc. Moreover, he has not listened to what his fellow countrymen said this morning. The lexicon has reached its climax already. So, please pay attention. I hope that I convince you to improve slightly the 30%. I did smile in the past. I'm not doing it now for several reasons. But having gone through the literature again, I'm convincing myself that it's something that I will restart soon. This morning, Zisis said that like LASIK is coming to its end, is already overexpanding, the future will be either trans-PRK, and we all agree on that. And Mills will try to fool you there as well, because he was talking about trans-PRK, Topo Gadi. That's nothing to do with LASIK. That's completely different. So let's remember that. Because it's the same if you end up with an irregular cornea. With LASIK or SMILE, you need to resort to trans-PRK, which is the future of excimer laser, in my view. So, small lenticle extraction since 2006. Now, the number are ever increasing, which is signs that something must work, otherwise the number would not increase. And also, let's remember, unlike femtosecond laser-assisted cataract surgery, where Bing Cobbing are dropping it, Zeiss had a big problem, invested lots of money to have femtosecond laser-assisted cataract surgery, dropped it. Now, other big companies are investing in femtosecond lenticule extraction technology, and they're getting there. Zimmer, Schwind, and more. So there must be something that works for this technique.
Vincenzo, I will help you. We don't see. Don't see the...
Sorry.
I mean, I could easily let you talk and talk and then
I was
win.
Too
but
excited.
Anyway, I'm a gentleman today, I told you. I'm a gentleman.
I was too excited by the debate, so let me just go back again, very briefly. Here we go. Apologies. So, we've seen the numbers, we've seen the company, and now let's go into the real things. So, review of meta-analysis. You know, I can show you the contrary of what Miltos has been showing you, because that's what happens sometimes with the papers. The real truth is that we are still waiting, and more randomized clinical trials are needed comparing SMILE versus LASIK. But if we look at this paper, the meta-analysis of SMILES versus LASIK published in 2015 showed that the predictability efficacy was the same, the safety and complication, there was not much of a difference. We do get complications with LASIK, and one disadvantage with LASIK is long-term complication. SMILE safety. If you look at the loss of one or more lines of best corrected visual acuity, there was no significant difference on the plot there in terms of odds ratio. Efficacy, the same. Predictability, identical. Look at this, no differences. And stability over time. Again, the five-year result seems to be very, very stable. Of course, after 5 years, refraction can change, but that's the same. That's why Bruce stated this morning that we tell our patient as they grow, no one can guarantee the stability of their refraction. But why SMILE could potentially be significantly better than LASIK, and why to do LASIK when both are possible? Well, with SMILE, there is no ablation-induced response. We preserve more the corneal neural architecture, which could lead, like Zeiss stated this morning, there is disagreement, I'm aware of that, to less dry eyes. And also, there could be retained corneal strength. For some, there is. For some, there isn't. And most important for me, there is no flap-related complication. If you can achieve the same result, why would you do a PKP rather than a DALK? Trauma. Patient comes back, lost the vision. Trauma after LASIK. I've seen patients after a stroke trauma. They were in a bar. By mistake, the stroke caught the eye. The flap went. Then you end up with scarring, poor vision, etc., etc. That's why the world is going in two directions, trans-PRK, SMILE. So, no ablation-induced response. That's simple to understand why. Because when you do PRK or LASIK, you kill cells, you get apoptosis, and you get more inflammation. And this shows you why it doesn't happen with SMILE, because you cut tissue and you pull it out. Preserving corneal neural architecture. Again, there is debate, but you know, some studies clearly show that the vertical cut done almost 360, apart from the inch during LASIK, will damage the nerve plexus more. And this is from my good friend and colleague, I have to thank him, Professor Mastro Pasqua Group, showing that with SMILE, you preserve the corneal neural architecture more and more. Retain corneal strength. Basically, is explained better perhaps in the next... I can understand why people think that there is more strength in the front of the cornea. It's still debatable, but if you look at some study, there is clearly, even when you look at the tensile strength with the corvus, a very minimal reduction after smile. It's almost compared with normal. But what really strikes me is the lack of this no flap-related complication. Yes, they can be sorted, but they are unpleasant to tell your patient, go back to the theater room just 24 hours after LASIK. Or even worse, and that's where the comparison between PKP and DALK is, flap dislocation in the long term. Never go out if you are a man with a girl with very long nails and upset her, even 10 years after your LASIK, because you can end up like that. I've seen it happening. They divorced, of course, but the chap was left with not great vision, and then they're very difficult to remedy, and you need to go back to the eczema laser indeed, but not LASIK, but topo-guided. Of course, you know, Miltos is absolutely right. The smile does have limitation, doesn't work really well for low myopia and high astigmatism. Retreatment are an issue because you need to use excimer laser. And hyperopia treatment, I don't think is there yet, but is coming soon. But in the right patient, if it was you, would rather have a flapless surgery that gives you the same outcome if you got -5, -6 or spherical myopia, or you'd go for LASIK with the different long-term risks. Moreover, smile may have future application. Think about treating patient with early keratoconus with homologous lenticle to avoid problems and minimize the risk of progression of keratoconus. So I hope that I've convinced you that Miltos has tried to just go on to your national sense, you know, since LASIK was invented here, but also that I've made you see the difference between excimer laser for trans-PAK and for LASIK. Thank you.
So let's vote again. Can we have the slides?
And vote for Greece.
One is smile, two is LASIK.
Or the contrary.
One is... So one is smile, two is LASIK. Oh God. Oh God. You did well. You did well. Oh, wow.
We have a winner. We have a winner.
I just want to thank you, everyone, because it's the first time in 3 years that I've won over Miltos. Thank you.
And especially with a smile. Eh? Let's go to the next debate.
I think it's just like Brexit. That was 52-48, wasn't it? I think we need a second referendum.
Absolutely.
I think I'm going to ask for that.
Let's give us the slide for the second debate, cross-linking on diagnosis, yes or no. Give us a slide to vote.
That's my talk. We need a vote. There we go, a voting slide.